Our next presenter is going to speak with us about lessons from the Haiti mobile money scenario. He is Michael Stéphane Bruno, the Executive Director of Digital Products and Services, Songe Bank. He was born in Port-au-Prince, Haiti. Michael Bruno is the, I can skip that over, that's the same sentence. Sorry. Prior to joining Songe Bank, Mr. Bruno has introduced the first cross-border mobile remittance service in Haiti in 2013 as the country manager for Boom Financial Inc., a California-based startup offering a digital alternative to money transfer services in Latin America and the Caribbean. Within 1 year, the startup was processing $200,000 per week in the Florida-Haiti corridor. Bruno's extensive mobile finance technology background stems from his role as senior technology advisor for Haiti Integrated Finance for Value Chains and Enterprise Projects, High Five, a USAID-funded project. Under High Five, chief of party leadership, he spearheaded the efforts of introducing mobile technology in the financial sector in Haiti. Bruno was instrumental in the partnership between USAID and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which resulted in the creation of the Haiti Mobile Money Initiative. HMMI facilitated the launch of two mobile money services in the Haitian market 9 months after the earthquake, shaking the financial sector that has been stagnant for some years. Mr. Bruno also conducted various mobile money consulting in Africa, namely Burkina Faso, and made various learning trips and appearances in conferences in more than 15 countries. He has a combination of experiences in the private sector, international organization and NGOs, and in the public sector as a consultant. Mr. Bruno would have stood up already and introduced himself when he asked his first question, and he's going to join me on the podium now to deliver his presentation on lessons from the Haiti mobile money scenario.
Good morning, everyone. First, I would like to thank you for having me here. I'm going to share my experiences and presenting the Haiti case in terms of mobile money and digital financial services in general. Currently, I'm acting executive director for digital strategy at Sogé Bank, which is one of the largest banks in Haiti. But everything that we'll say here is not the official position of the bank, right? It's just because of my involvement in those past projects that I'm here to present to you. So basically, we're going to talk about the Haiti Mobile Money Initiative to understand the background of that project and what were the results and the perspectives, the lessons learned, and what is the current state of the market in Haiti today. And particularly because yesterday there were some comments about that program, so I'm glad to be here to tell you firsthand exactly what happened. So the background, in 2009, USAID launched a project. The name of the project was High Five, which is basically a funding mechanism that was used to allow financial institutions to introduce technology in the operations. So of course, part of that mandate was also to make an assessment about mobile money to see how we could introduce mobile money on the Haitian market. That was in 2009. At the end of 2009, we were basically, the way the funding mechanism was working is that a financial institution has a project, can come to us, we analyze the project, they bring 25% of the cost of the project, and we can fund 75% of the project. So this was the mechanism that was used to help all financial institutions in Haiti to modernize their services. So in late 2009, we were basically about to sign an agreement with one of the mobile operators, Voila, which has had the mobile money product that they were launching on the market. And when the earthquake happened in January, everything came to a stop. And this is when the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation came to the market and saw that as an opportunity to introduce mobile money, because of the fact that more than one-third of bank branches were destroyed in the earthquake. Banks were closed for more than 2 weeks, but people could not get to their cash. So it was an opportunity to introduce mobile money. So what they did is that, since there was already a USAID project on the ground working, so they decided to do a partnership with USAID. And we talked about a different way to approach this. Instead of coming with an additional funding mechanism, we thought about introducing a price mechanism, where basically we tell the operators, you build the service, you reach a certain criteria, and you can have access to a price. So basically, the project was a $10 million project. The objective was to accelerate the introduction of such services in the market, to achieve scale rapidly, and to have sustainable services. The projects launched in June 2010, so basically a few months after the earthquake, and lasted about 2 years. So the approach was that on one hand with the price mechanism, we want to help on the supply side of more money, and on the other hand with the funding mechanism that already existed within High Five, we wanted to help companies that wanted to include these services into their operations. So we wanted to intervene in both the supply and the demand side. There were various phases in the competition. The first phase was that the operators needed to have at least 100 agents and a total of at least 10,000 transactions, cash in and cash out, to be able to access the first prize. The premise of that was that if we want to introduce more money, it was very important to have an ecosystem of agents where people can go to do their cash in and their cash out. So that's why the Gates Foundation in particular wanted to have this first phase first. And then after that, we were going to look at P2P transactions and all of that. So the first phase was to introduce the agents, the agent network. And then the second and the third phase was about now scaling, meaning based on the number of transactions, the number of people that are using the service. So that was the structure of the competition. As a result of this, two products were launched in the market from Digicel in partnership with Scotia Bank, and Voila, which is another mobile network operator in partnership with another bank in the system. By 2012, we had reached about 800,000 subscribers and about 2,000 agents in the market. So this shows you the evolution of the number of customers that we had during that period. You will see that in green, it's Voila, they had an edge over Digicel at some point. And at a certain period, Digicel crossed that mark in terms of the number of registered customers. So basically, if we look at the uptake of the services in 2 years, it was actually, we reached actually 10% of the population, which is basically a world record in terms of launching a new mobile money service in every market, thanks to that competition. So I already talked about the context, about long lines in the streets, the bank branches that were destroyed. That was the context that all of those services were introduced. Now, what is very important to understand is that one of the ways this scaling was achieved rapidly is because with the earthquake, you know that there were a lot of NGOs working in Haiti. There were a lot of cash forward programs. And all the operators took advantage of these cash forward programs to basically increase the number of transactions that they are doing, basically by registering these people, making sure that these payments are made through mobile money services. This is one of the ways that they have been able to achieve such high number of transactions. You will see that at some point, the Haitian market was basically a laboratory for NGOs to use mobile money instead of cash disbursements for their operations. And there were a lot of studies made during that period that showed the benefit of using mobile money versus cash payments. So there were various studies that were made around that in terms of cost, security, and speed. But the disadvantage of using the NGO programs is that the fact that they were introduced as part of the NGO program, many customers, they got confused. They believed that this system was just a system to receive their payments. They didn't fully understand exactly what is the extent of what they were using, that they could use it outside of the NGO programs to do other things. In other contexts as well, at the end of the project, of the NGO project, if there is no money for people to use their wallet, they basically stop using it. So there was an advantage of using these services to increase the number of transactions, but the drawback was that at the end of these programs, because these programs by definition were temporary, the operators did not do a good job in maintaining these clients, maintaining it active, and continue to develop the ecosystem so that they can continue have a use for the mobile wallet that they had acquired as part of the NGO program. The other obstacles were regulatory. So basically, a few months before the launch of the services, the Central Bank of Haiti decided that only financial institutions were authorized to launch such services. So if you were a mobile operator or an independent technology company, you had to partner with the bank in order to offer that service. So basically, this put the bank at, this gave a leverage to the banks in terms of negotiations, because you couldn't do nothing basically if you didn't have this partnership with the bank. So this was one of the major decisions that kind of changed the game in the mobile money market in Haiti. So the lessons learned. Using a price mechanism to foster the development of these products were new. It was the first time that we were trying something like that, and particularly for aid or organizations or international donors, it was the first time that they were using such schemes. Usually, we are used to have price mechanisms to develop prototypes of products, but it is very rare to have a price mechanism to actually launch a real product on the market. So, for example, the operators had to be very aggressive in terms of acquiring the customers, and of course there was an incentive to try to game the system. So what we did to actually control this is that we had extensive verification. For example, if you tell me you have 100 agents, we actually had people deployed all over the country to verify the existence of these agents, take picture of them, you know, ask questions and everything. We also had mystery clients that were going incognito to do transactions at the agents' locations to make sure that they are operational. So there was a number of procedures and measures that were made, that were taken in order to make sure that the transactions were real and the customers were real. In terms of the transactions, for example, we had basically a call center where people were calling randomly the clients to make sure that these are real clients making the transactions. We even hired KPMG to do some data forensics, for example, by using something called the Binford Law that allows you to detect transactions that are made up. For example, there's a pattern if you try to do arbitrary transactions, the same numbers are going to come back. So we use that in order to eliminate some transactions and also eliminating all offsetting transactions. The offsetting transactions were the fact that I send you $10, you send it back to me, or I send it to you, you send it to that person, and he sends it back to me. So we were able to eliminate many, many transactions like that that were gaming schemes, and in order to have something that we could be confident that was that were real. So there were extensive measures taken in order to counteract these gaming things. The other thing also is that, remember, the mobile money products were introduced in the context of the earthquake. So there was a lot of focus about alleviation, helping the vulnerable population displaced. And unfortunately, this had a bad connotation on mobile money. Like, mobile money was for cash for work or was for poor people with problems. So many people didn't assimilate themselves to these products because of this connotation, because of the context and that those products were were introduced. The guidelines of the central bank is another thing that I've already mentioned. The central bank was very cautious about opening the gates for such services. And actually, one of the decisions that they made was actually purposely a good one, the fact that the central bank allowed the introduction of what they call the mini wallets, which allow a customer to basically sign up for an account from your phone without even having to go to an agent, basically anonymously. Of course, you have a very low balance that you are allowed to have on your account to prevent the risk of fraud anti-money laundering and all of that. This particular disposition allowed people to the operators to sign up customers more easily. However, we find out in the long run that customers that sign up that way tend to be less afterwards in the service than those who actually went through the process of meeting an agent, understanding the product. Even if it takes time, it is more cumbersome, but at least the customer is more engaged and is more prone to be active, to continue to be active in the long run. So basically, the fact that we allow people to sign up with much less effort, there is a right balance to find between that and making sure that the person knows what he's signing up for and understand what the product is to truly become a valuable customer for the service. And then last, mobile money was sexy at that time. Everybody, until today, we talk about that. Even now, we are moving to cryptocurrency and all of that. One of the things I think it's very important to understand is that the focus should not be in a specific technology, but finding the right way, the right tool for the right people for digital financial services in general. We cannot force things onto people. The products have to adapt to their ways of doing things, the cultural context and all of that. And this is a focus that, this is a shift that personally I've made, is to make sure that we have a bunch of different technologies outside that we can use, and sometimes in different contexts and different scenarios, one tool works better than the other. So be less technology, we have to be technology agnostic, but the concept of digital financial services should be centered and should be using all the different tools that are available in order to address the needs of the population that we are targeting. Because if we don't identify exactly what problem we want to solve for the customer, the technology can be as sexy as we want, they're not gonna buy into it. So for example, I'm not going to get back to all the discussions, the philosophical discussions that we had in the beginning between the Gates Foundation, USAID, Haitians. There was a lot of discussion about the philosophy, what we want. Are we going to replicate M-Pesa? Are we going to do something Haitian? Or are we going to? There was a lot of philosophical discussions around that. I cannot say that one was right, the other was wrong, because at that time, based on the information that was available, there was no right or wrong. However, I think that for digital financial services to work in any country, basically, is that we need to understand that there are different segments of the market. We need to cater to the needs of the different segments of the market. It's not, there's not one size fits all, and we want to make sure that we start from the customer and we find the solution, instead of starting from the solution and finding the customer afterward. So we have different categories of customers that have different needs and have different tools at their disposal that we want to take into account. So one of the things that I think personally would make sense is to really try to develop the ecosystem through developers, allow our financial system and the financial instruments that we have to allow innovation around them, so that people can build specific solutions for specific industries by relying on a technology that works across the financial system in general. So basically, we have different scenarios. We have face-to-face transactions. We have remote transactions, offline and online. We have end-to-end automated process where you actually make a transaction with a system, not necessarily with another person. A transaction can be initiated by a user, but it can be initiated by a merchant too. So there are different use cases, there are different scenarios, and the digital financial services that we build for the market needs to be open so that people can be innovative and try to build value-added services on top of the basic function of a financial system or a payment system. So for example, we can have core functions in these systems, deposit, withdrawals, crediting or checking an account and everything. Strategic services that can be offered by the provider itself. For example, if I'm a bank, I have a payment system, I might have a payroll service that is natural for me to provide, but I can also open my system to third-party developers to build other kind of solutions for their industries. So we have different levels that we can have on top of a payment system using different technologies. So based on the target population and the scenario that we want to cover, we might use virtual currency, a mobile wallet, card, and all the different tools that are at our disposal. For example, there were already some progress in the Haitian market. Some third-party companies who built systems for customers and businesses that were linked to the mobile money products. We were talking about the SUSU this morning. So for example, there was one group working with CARE that wanted to find a way to do a SUSU, but electronically with the mobile wallets of the customers and a central wallet that is shared by everyone. This app was made by a company who developed an electronic voucher solution that were used by UNDP and other NGOs for people that were receiving vouchers, but they could only buy some specific products at specific merchant locations. So all of that was built on top of the mobile money services that were offered by the operators. But this required a specific agreement between the developer and the service provider. So the point was to make sure that it becomes an API so that any developer can do it without having a privileged access to the platform of the service provider. So now, fast forward, we are now in 2016. What is left from all this? So like you were, like yesterday, we saw that despite the fact that we had reached about 800,000 accounts by 2012, today, the number of people that are using mobile money has been down to about 60,000. One of the reasons why that happened is because, unfortunately, in 2012, Digicel acquired Voilà. So basically, they retired the T-Cash service in the market, and they migrated all the active accounts to their platform. And therefore, there was only one operator on the market. So that stifled, you know, there was no longer competition. They spent about 1 year. They migrated to another platform. They did not do any kind of promotion. So that kind of slowed the progress of mobile money. But in the meantime, other operators have entered the market, like L'Argent Cash and Boom Financial Inc. In particular, because I had left in the meantime and launched Boom, which was in the mobile money remittance market. Although the company had to leave the Haiti market in 2015 for other reasons. That's a long story that I could, that's a different presentation. But basically, all the banks afterwards now either have a mobile money product or they are doing agency banking, meaning having agents now to do branchless banking, or they have a mobile banking product. So basically, with that introduction, the HMMI, even if they have not achieved the final objective of having sustainable mobile money services, but it really shaped the financial system today that is now moving a lot in that direction. In particular, in Sojay Bank, for example, we recently launched a product called Sojay Easy. In fact, Easy, it's written in Creole, but it really means easy. Like the English word easy, it is basically a lightweight account with very light KYC requirement. Basically, it requires one piece of ID, no proof of address. You can register in about 20 minutes. It works with your fingerprint. You also get a debit card. There's no minimum balance required for the account, and when you register, you're automatically enrolled in the internet banking system, in the mobile banking service as well. So you can also use the mobile app on your smartphone to use that same account. And we recently introduced this week, the EMV. So now all our POS and everything is EMV ready. We now have the chip in the cards. So basically, it's an hybrid product which combines the mobile money aspect and the card aspect, because we have found that in the Asian market, in particular, I don't know if it's the same in the other markets, that people still give a lot of, they are still attracted to the card product. So in order to ease the introduction of the mobile, we cannot entirely eliminate the card product. So the product that we have today is hybrid, which uses both, you know, the best of both worlds. Basically, in some situation, the card works because you swipe it. If you have a long line behind you, it's not, you know, and everybody's waiting, it's not the time for you to type on your phone to make a payment. But if you want to do a remote transaction, you're stuck in traffic, for example, the mobile is a better tool than the card. So different ways of using the same account by using different channels, that is the way that we see the future going forward. In particular, there are some opportunities here, like the penetration of smartphones. In 2013, the situation was that basically only 29% of phones in circulation were data capable, where from that we had about 10% that were smartphones between BlackBerry and Android and iPhone. And in 2013, most of the smartphones were BlackBerries. So basically we had about 4% of smartphone that had that data plan. 40% of the customers that had a smartphone had a data plan. 60% of them, despite the fact that they had a smartphone, didn't have internet on that phone. So 2 years later, the situation is this. So basically we have 21% of the mobile phones in circulation that are smartphones today. And from that, 94% of them are non-BlackBerry, meaning Android and iPhone. And of course, 90% of those phones are Android phones. So basically we went from 4% of smartphone users to 21% of smartphone users in 2 years, which, and today, 70% of people that have a smartphone also have a data plan. So it means that in 2 years, we went from about 64,000 smartphone users with internet to about 1 million smartphone users with internet today. And it's growing, it's still growing. So while the mobile money services that were launched in 2010 were mostly based on USSD, SMS, and so forth, more and more today, we're going to see these services move to more apps, smartphone, and things like that, which will allow us to actually provide better service. And paradoxically, the more you have people that are illiterate, it's easier to provide a service with a smartphone than using USSD, because USSD, basically, you have to type everything, choose in the menu, etc. Whereas in a smartphone app, you have more the opportunity to use images and other kinds of user interface to even cater to those that are illiterate. And of course, Android phones and tablets rule in Haiti. We even have a local company that is building Android tablets. So that's basically, if I take 1 million smartphone users, it's basically the entire population of the OECS countries there. So in conclusion, the Haiti Mobile Money Initiative did not achieve all its objectives. We wanted to introduce mobile money very quickly, we did. But some of them were short-lived because in the meantime, the market has changed. Unfortunately, these are the things that you can't control. However, this objective shaped the market, that's why today all banks are finding a way to work in that space. And most of the people that were involved in the mobile money services at that time ended up either working at the bank, working on their digital strategy, like myself, for example, and the banks are using these experiences to actually go into branchless banking, mobile banking, mobile money, and card transactions and all of that. In fact, today, there is a race to go to the next frontier because the metropolitan area, urban people, the market is becoming more saturated. They need now to go out and to reach new markets and new customers. And they are looking at ways to reach those customers at lower cost. So basically, everybody is interested in agency banking, in using mobile a lot to reach these customers, either to replace the traditional POS devices that that merchants have, and also to equip customers to have lower cost devices that they can use to perform their different transactions. And basically, what you want to ask yourself is, what is the problem that you want to solve? What is the right tool to solve that problem? Okay? And not fall into the trap of being, you know, a fan of a specific technology and trying to impose that passion that you have for that technology to customers. We have seen very innovative products. For example, with Boom Financial, when we were doing the mobile remittances, we were we had the lowest price in the market. Basically, what you would pay for one transaction in the competition, you were doing it entirely free for the whole month. You were paying like for the first transaction, and every other transaction for the month, unlimited, were free. So there was no competition in terms of pricing. The technology was there, it was instant. You were receiving it directly on your mobile wallet, but it still didn't get the 1 million customers we needed in 2 years to be break even. So sometimes things take time, and you have to make sure that you educate the customer, you find exactly what is the pain point that you want to address to that customer in order for them to accept the product and to be successful in the market. So thank you, and I'm open for questions that you might have. Thank you.
Great timing. Do you have any questions for Michael? We can't be that hungry. We really have no questions? Okay, we've got back up nicely to the 12:30. There's one.
Hello? Yes, good afternoon. My name is Anissa Duncan from Telecoms Authority in Trinidad and Tobago. And my question to you, you're not hearing.
Just tilt it up a little bit more.
Anissa Duncan from Telecommunications Authority in Trinidad and Tobago. And my question to you would be, what role has the regulators, both the telecom regulator and the central bank regulator, played in facilitating mobile money in Haiti?
In September 2010, the central bank issued guidelines for mobile money in Haiti, because before, there was nothing about mobile money specifically. There was nothing about agency banking, the fact that banks can use third-party agents that are non-bank branches to offer financial services. So in order to allow such services to launch, the central bank issued guidelines in September 2010 to tell them, here's how you can do basically mobile money. However, the fact that these guidelines were made very quickly on a rush it wasn't entirely coherent, because basically what they should look more like something that would regulate branchless banking more than anything else. So this is one of the loopholes that I use myself as Boom to actually launch without having an authorization from the central bank, because basically we made a legal argument to say what you should regulate branchless banking. We're not doing branchless banking. We offer a product through the credit unions, but because our partnership was with the credit unions, and basically the transfers are being made from one account to another, things that are already within what is allowed for a credit union. So the other thing that the central bank did is that they set some limits in terms of balance, in terms of transaction volumes that we can do with such accounts. So this is why, for example, all the mobile money products that were launched had a specific balance that you had to comply to. So these are the kind of things that the central bank issued. And most importantly, the central bank put the bank at the center, saying only financial institutions, basically commercial banks and credit unions, deposit-taking institutions are allowed to offer such services. And even if a third-party operator, a technology company, a mobile network operator, if they come with a product, they will have to partner with the bank in order to offer it. And everything that happens at an agent location, even if it's created by the operator, is the responsibility of the bank. So the bank has to approve each agent, has to make sure that all the procedures are in place in terms of anti-money laundering and everything. And everything that happens there is the responsibility of the bank. So the bank has had the power to veto any kind of product that you could offer. That happened to me, where we were working on an interoperability between my service, Boom, and Digicel service, which was Social Mobile at that time. Although the technical arms of the consortium agreed on everything, on the technologies and everything, but because my financial institution and the financial institution of DSL could not agree on a settlement, they basically killed the interoperability project that we had. So these are the kind of things that happen that can stifle innovation by tech companies like ourselves. On the telecommunication side, the Conseil National de Télécommunication, which is the regulator that regulates the telecommunication, they also issued guidelines in terms of the technical aspect of the mobile money platforms, in terms of security and everything that needed to happen in order to be able to allow to offer such services. But there wasn't a real cooperation between the central bank and the telco regulator. It was like everybody was trying to, pull the thing on, this is my jurisdiction, so I have to say something. That's more what happened instead of having a really comprehensive approach where the roles of the central bankers and the telco regulators were clearly defined. But I understand everybody was rushing because the market was doing faster than them, so they tried to basically rush to have something in place to make sure that once the products are launched, there's a minimum of rules or guidelines to regulate these services.
Shiva Bisasa, Pen Architect Energy Solutions. You had something up on one of your slides, the cash in, cash out, if that's your prerogative, you're in problems. And I think that was as well spoken to by Vijay yesterday in the DFS, the ITU DFS presentation. How important is that, and how important is it how do you maintain or build, if you are using a mobile money solution within your nation, how important is it to have have the ability to keep money in that format rather than cashing and cashing out?
Actually, that was our position. I think that one of the first meetings we had between the Gates Foundation, we had to agree to disagree in order to move on, because we thought that it was more important for us to have an ecosystem where you have a payment instrument that you can use everywhere to make payments, buy goods, etc. And this is exactly why I was saying it is not about replicating M-Pesa, because M-Pesa in the beginning, it was barely, well, when I say barely, I don't want to, it's not like what they did was extraordinary, but it was basically a money transfer service. It was a way for you to move money across vast regions very fast. So people were cashing in, sending money to someone else, that person was immediately cashing out to the transaction. There was no merchant payments and so forth. Of course, informally, if you go to the small merchant at the corner of the street, you can pay him like that, but it wasn't through merchant payments and all of that. In fact, when I met with a number of developers in Kenya, they were all complaining that Safaricom is closed, they don't want to open their API so that they can build value-added services on top of what they have. It took at least three, four years before we started really seeing real merchant payments on the M-Pesa platform. So I did not want to replicate that. For me, the issue in Haiti is the handling of cash. Cash costs a lot. We have to basically renew our cash every 3 months, if my memory is right, because the cash is so much abused. So it's very costly to maintain liquidity, cash liquidity and actually transporting cash to those places so that people can have them to use is also an issue. It's not like in Kenya where they have good roads. You can get very far, very fast by road. It's not like that in Haiti. 75% of our land is mountains. So yes, we believe that building an ecosystem so that you can allow people to buy, so that they rely less in cash, that's what we believe in. However, in the negotiations, they wanted to start with the cash in cash out network. They were bringing more money than us anyway, so we had to actually agree on that. But we tried afterwards to introduce this API mentality, opening the network so that developers can do it. And we were basically starting to see things while there was a competition. But at some point, when there was only one operator on the market, this became difficult. But I think that we're going to catch up. Like I said, many different things are happening now in the Haitian market. Personally, we are already working on e-commerce solutions so that we can allow Haitians to actually have merchant accounts to accept payments online and all of that. So all of these are projects that are going to, we're going to see where it lands us, in 1-2 years from now, based on the experiences we had in the market in the past.
Yes, the microphone is on table one.
Hello, all right. Good day, Kenta Sujie from St. Lucia. Mm-hmm. Very informative presentation. I just want to ask quickly, in terms of the government, what legislation or policies were in place prior to you establishing this?
Basically, there was none. There's the banking law. There was a banking law that governs, banking. But banks had already launched internet banking. We have ATMs and all of that, but having a third party providing account to people, signing up users, going to agents in non-bank, there was nothing that
would regulate such activities prior to that. In fact, the governor of the central bank at that time, actually, he said, well, basically, you forced me to actually, address those questions and bring legislation, even if they are imperfect, but at least there is something that says now banks can use agents, non-bank agents, to provide a subset of financial services. There's something now that allows them to do that, and that's why three biggest banks are all involved in branchless banking operations, in either through a mobile money product or through traditional banking services through third-party agents. So it is thanks to that they have come up with these guidelines that allow the banks to explore these new ways, these new channels to reach new customers and to provide value-added services.
We have one more.
Hi, I'm Nicole from the telecom regulator in Suriname. Mm-hmm. My question is regarding to the cost for connecting, cost connected to interoperability. Would it have helped if the cost were regulated? Because you also you said that it's those costs killed the deal with Digicel, right? So are you a proponent that the regulator would have regulated those costs and that would be already available then?
Okay, so in our case, it wasn't the cost that killed it. It was the fact that the financial institutions that are backing our respective products could not agree on a settlement model. So basically there was a, I could say, ego fight between two financial institutions. There's a network of credit unions, which we are working with, and there's Scotia Bank, which is a subsidiary of an international bank. So the bank was saying, you need to open an account at my place so that I can settle directly with you. The others were saying, well, if I'm opening your place, you have to open an account at my place too, because we have to deal with we're in the same level. So basically, long story short, they couldn't agree on a settlement, and basically we could not interoperate with the other mobile money operator. But the technical work was done. Actually, maybe that was the mistake. If we had involved them further in the beginning, maybe we would have seen in advance that this won't work. It would have stopped. But after 6 months of work, $100,000 of work to do the interoperability didn't happen because they couldn't agree. But however, there is still the possibility of an operator having uncompetitive practices, because if I'm a third-party mobile money operator and I need to use USSD channel to provide my service, and for example, Digicel or Natcom, they also have their own mobile money service, so maybe the regulator can make sure that there is no uncompetitive practices. So the price that I charge myself for my service should have the same price that I charge a competitor that needs the USSD channel to provide a service that is in competition with mine. But I cannot say that happened. We didn't have a case like that in the country, but it is known that operators in general, they are very difficult to work with when you need access to USSD in particular. So that's why with the smartphone revolution, internet based, you have now we have the option to actually bypass all of that and not having to have a special agreement with an operator to do it. Actually, there's one bank that uses a different technology to avoid that. The L'Argent Cash product uses what they call the NSFT, which is near sound data transfer, which uses actually a voice call to perform the transaction. So no special agreement needed with the operator. As long as one network can call the other one, the transaction will take place.
Okay, since we seem to have no more questions, we've caught back up a little bit, almost, to time with where we should be going to lunch. We've had a good morning.